Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the fourth meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2024. There are no apologies this morning. And agenda item one is for the committee to decide on taking items later in the agenda in private. Are the members in agreement to take agenda item three and four in private? Item three is consideration of the evidence the committee will hear during the Scottish Information Commissioner's evidence session. And item four is consideration of the report on hybrid proceedings. Are members content to take those in private? I'm grateful. Our next item is for the committee to hear evidence from the Scottish Information Commissioner. And can I welcome David Hamilton, Commissioner? David is joined by Ewan McCulloch and Claire Stephen today. And first of all, can I congratulate you on your appointment, David? This is your first battle meeting with the committee. So the principal purpose of today is obviously to talk about the annual report. So can I hand over to you for some introductory comments?
Certainly. Thanks, Convener, and thank you, Committee, for the opportunity to come and speak to you today. This is my 16th week in post. It's been a quite extraordinary last 15 weeks with a lot of things happening. In fact, at the beginning of my first week was when the first opening salvos opened between the COVID UK inquiry and Scottish Government. So it's been pretty much set the tone for my period of time in office. Since then, I've also been to the Court of Session. We've had further COVID UK inquiry drama, shall we say, and indeed a number of announcements regarding legislation. So what I was expecting to get in my first year, I think I've had in 15 weeks. So it's been fairly fast pace. I am genuinely honoured and proud to take on leadership of this organisation and to take on the role of Scottish Information Commissioner. I have got a fantastic staff, two of whom are with us here. In fact, three with my colleague at the back. Really impressed by the dedication and the commitment which the staff in St Andrews have to getting to the purpose of freedom of information, giving that access to all. Again, I do need to first of all pay recognition to the giants who have gone before me and whose shoulders I stand. Kevin Dunyon, Rosemary Agnew, and of course Darren Fitzhenry, my most immediate predecessor. They've left me an organisation and indeed a regime which is in a good position. And despite a lot of the narrative, which we'll no doubt explore a bit more today, I think I take a lot of comfort from the fact that freedom of information is working well in Scotland. There are a number of high-profile incidents, which of course we're addressing, but as a whole, it works well. Now, I took office, as I say, back in October. It was just after the annual report and accounts were laid by my predecessor, Darren Fitzhenry. So it's not my report. However, I recognise and agree with everything within the contents of the report. So I will certainly do my best and with the team. If there's any particular questions in that, we will be able to cover those. I think probably worthwhile saying, though, that since then, as well as the issues I've talked about, there have been a number of other developments, which, again, I'm perhaps more qualified in terms of speaking about. First of all, of course, is my requirement to lay a strategic plan to the Parliament. That happens every 4 years. And again, it's fallen upon me to set my next 4 years of work with a relatively little amount of experience. So my approach to that has been to do my best in setting out a plan, but I will revisit that next year and make sure that it's appropriate and just. What I think is important, though, is just to set out some of the tactical priorities, which I've recognised already. And I'm going to cover these in my further remarks. But workload stabilisation is a key one, and that's essentially dealing with the backlog, which, unfortunately, we have within the office. Also about building interventions and the capacity for that, which I consider to be one of the jewels of the crown of the a sort of toolbox I have, and also supporting and promoting legislative change, which again is a fairly good and hot topic just now. So first of all, the backlog. It's unfortunate that we have a backlog. It's something that has built up. Like within many organisations, it's partly down to COVID, it's partly down to the legacy of that. But we are now in a position where we are dealing with that. Fundamentally, we couldn't keep up with demand that was coming in. And the resourcing has now, we've now put in measures in place whereby we have now stopped the bleed in terms of we've got control of that. But what we're also now doing is dealing with that backlog in a managed and slightly different way, which I think has been generally well received across the organisation. What ultimately that does is it preserves the system for everyone. Because my concern was that if someone was to put an appeal into my office today without any action, they could be waiting 18 months, 2 years for before it was even considered. And that's not an acceptable position to be in. So what we've now done is we've made it a straight through process, and we are seeing that all the cases that came from the beginning of January are now progressing straight through to allocation, investigation, and that's just dealing with the current cases. We do, of course, need to deal with the backlog, and we are working with that. We've got additional resources have now been confirmed by the corporate body to help us with that, and we're biting our way through that, and we will get through that chunk as well. It's a different approach we're taking. We're trying to do slightly different approaches in terms of pairing up cases and matching issues. But it's been, so far, looks promising in terms of us getting there. And essentially what we're doing is preserving the system for the current system and dealing with what we have to deal with from the past. I mentioned the interventions. Of course, there are two major interventions just now. One is the Scottish, well, both are Scottish Government. One of the Scottish Government interventions is a long-running one that we hope to bring to a conclusion next year, at the beginning of next year. We're in a good position, I think, with that now. It's been sometimes been described as a game of two halves. It's probably more a game of four quarters. It was bad, it got good. COVID happened, it got bad, it's getting good again. And what we're now seeing is actually exceptional performance, but that needs to be sustained. And that's where what we're checking just now is sustainability of that general performance. The second intervention is unrelated, and that's to do with the informal communications, which again is, I think we'll no doubt touch on that more, but that's something which is a live intervention just now. I'm hoping not to have to go into too much just now because, first of all, we're still at the evidence gathering stage and pulling in the information. And once we see that, we'll have a better consideration, and maybe for a future session, we'll be able to delve into that more on things. And then finally, on the legislative aspect, it was disappointing that the Scottish Government decided not to choose to go down a primary legislation route. There is some legislation that requires to be looked at from our perspective. And we do, however, welcome the fact that at least the Section 60 and 61 codes of practice are going to be reviewed. And already are engaging with both the Keeper of the Records and indeed Scottish Government with how we can improve that. I think the other bill, of course, is the Private Members Bill, Katie Clark's bill. We kind of wait to see where that's going. There's some interesting ideas and concepts that have been floated through that consultation. And again, with that, we kind of wait and see what the final detail will be. But I think one of the things which we are keen to see is a more agile way of expanding the accessibility or the coverage of freedom of information to a number of organisations, not by a gateway clause, because we do, having considered that carefully, think that could cause more problems than actually we're looking for, but from a more structured timetable way that could be maybe even involving Parliament in terms of designation, not just Scottish Government. So, Chair, convener, that is my opening remarks. Very happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, David. And just before I leap in, I just want to put on record my and the committee's thanks to your predecessor, Darren Fitzhenry, who was the principal author of the annual report. And I think it's interesting that in his opening, he too commented, quote, "It has been a privilege as well as a pleasure to be at the helm over the past 6 years, and particularly to work with such an excellent team." So the team have obviously got their commissioners very well trained, but I think it does in reality reflect your role, which is one as the head of a team that does it. And so I'd like to thank Darren both for the help and assistance that he gave to this committee, his openness towards us, but also more importantly his role as Scottish Commissioner over the previous period. And you know, David, you've sort of set out your reflections on I was going to say the first few months, but I think the first few weeks of your role very clearly. And we will obviously explore what your view is of where freedom of information is in Scotland, but based on a platform that it's in a good place and we're looking to seek improvement. You mentioned your strategic plan, which is a four-year plan, which obviously is due to be laid this year, but you made mention of revisiting that next year. Would your intention be to extend it therefore beyond 28 to 29, or in essence look at a three-year plan once you have understandably a better understanding and indeed had the opportunity to put an input to what your priorities are?
If I could, I would, but unfortunately I'm constrained by the four-year cycle. What I've got, I think, in the strategic plan is something that would stand the test of time anyway. But I do think it would be wise to be able to reflect after a bit more time in the job. And also once we see a bit more certainty regarding other aspects, for example, the extension of FOI to other agencies. So I think it was one of these difficult calls. The temptation was just to tinker with what was there from last time. But the reality is, as soon as you start picking it, you've got to deal with some of the issues. It's more than a refresh. It is something which I'm proud of and I think stands the test of time on its own merits. But I would like to have a clearer certainty as to where the legislative picture is going to be next year. And I think we should be in that position.
So rather than a new strategic plan, it will be more a one-year analysis of where we are, but also a three-year looking forward analysis of where you would like to get in it.
Absolutely. And I think the particular challenges of the first year will be different to the ones of year two onwards.
That's very helpful. Thank you. I'm going to throw you to the mercy of the committee now. So, Ivan, would you like to
thank you, Cathina.
Good
morning. I'd just like to explore a wee bit round about the backlog and the caseload numbers. I think you're indicating that you've seen the number of new cases reducing, and it was just to get your sense of why you think that is, and you see that, you anticipate that continuing to be the case.
Yes, thanks. Our demand has been fairly steady over the last 4 years. It's been up and down. Where the difficulty has been is matching that demand to resourcing. The throughput of work has actually increased. The staff have responded well to the challenges. But despite all the different system changes which have been made by my predecessors, fundamentally it came down to there wasn't enough people to deal with the accumulating demand. And what we've now got is in a position where we've got a much leaner operating model for workforce planning that is making sure that we don't have any gaps in recruitment, that we're much tidier and cleaner on these things so that we don't let these that gap run away again. So we're in a good position now with that. We've since I've started, I've now got five new members of staff who weren't there when I did start. That's not a sustainable increase of a member of staff every 3 weeks. It's probably not bad, but not sustainable. But it's made a big impact of morale to the staff in the office because they see that we're keen to fix this. I think the other thing which is important to recognise is the complexities of some of the cases have been a surprise to me. And I've got that kind of new boy perspective that I can come in and say, wow, I would have thought that would have been an easy decision to make. And then you begin to read the arguments and the complexities of it. And some of the issues have been very, very technical. You'll be aware of the Loch Arbour cases, which are a significant amount of public money used to support a very vulnerable part of the country geographically. And the complexities and indeed the responsibilities of decision-making that we make there rests heavily, to be honest, when we're making these calls. So it's something we need to get right, and it's something we need to have a mind for, not just in terms of legal challenge, but what's the right thing to do for people of Scotland and for communities.
Thanks for that. Yeah, I was going to ask for that complexity. Clearly, those bump into the cost restriction at some point. So I suppose that puts a limit on how complex the cases can be until they breach that that limit.
It does. I mean, I think the one thing I would say is that the cost limit hasn't changed in the 20 years of legislation, and that seems a bit of an anomaly to me. £600 is that threshold that, if we were to index link that, I suspect we'd probably need 2,000 or so. I don't know if my colleagues have an exact number on that one, but it's certainly several, you know, way above what it should be. And that, I think, brings into a question mark as to whether that needs to get changed. But again, that's a primary legislation question.
Is there any... I'm just talking on that. Sorry.
If I may... very often the more complex cases, the more legally complex cases, the cases involving complex arguments in relation to exemptions, don't engage the cost limit exemption because things like thinking time in relation to applying exemptions aren't matters you can take into account in costing a request.
Sorry, so what you're saying is that the cost number doesn't include all the cost? Did you just repeat?
Basically, yes. You can't take account of the time required to think about whether a particular exemption applies.
Right, okay. So that's excluded from the cost calculation.
So legally complex matters will not necessarily engage the costing provisions.
Okay, I understand. You mentioned kind of redefining the process. I think there's a different triage process, et cetera, et cetera. So that is good to hear all of that. Clearly, perhaps more work on proactive release of information, a standardised form might help that. And I'm assuming that's something on your agenda. You can confirm that. And then to what extent are you looking at new technology, AI and so on and so forth to help speed up the process to some extent?
Yeah, I mean, I think the AI is a really interesting perspective just now. I prefer to call it assisted technology than AI, because I think the AI badge just stays at the wrong place. One of the things which we are doing is engaging with other regulators across the UK to see how AI is impacting. We already know that there are artificial intelligence packages that are doing freedom of information requests. So in order to respond to that, yes, I know, really the authorities need to have an equality of arms, which means AI packages to answer the requests. Although the other approach to that could be a much more open publication and self-service aspect. And I think that's the kind of model which I tend to favour, because otherwise you get into a kind of arms race, which doesn't really get you anywhere. It's just who's got the fastest computer. Where the most benefits can be achieved are in changing that culture of publishing by design. And again, this is where the whole publication scheme aspect really needs to come in.
It's interesting. See a culture, and I suspect Stephen's going to jump on that, so I'll leave it to him to jump on that. My final question, just to throw this out there, is there any calculation or sense of the scope of how much the whole FOI process costs right across the public sector in terms of pulling information together?
There's not. I guess the question is, how do you measure it? It'll mean different things to different people, different costs. Again, I would encourage public authorities to start looking at this in terms of how can we cut down our FOI response costs. Well, don't have people asking for FOIs because they can self-serve. So if you can go to a website and get all the information you require, that seems to be intrinsically a much more sensible approach than having to ask somebody to give something that's in the cupboard.
And how much impact do you think that could have? Is it could have a significant impact on the caseload you see?
I think it could be significant. Yeah. We have got, I think last year it was 84,000 freedom of information requests across the country that we know of. But that's a significant amount of data processing that's going on there. And if people can do that themselves, and I think the SEPA is quite a good example of this, where a lot of consultants are using FOI to get information out, and I think the approach that SEPA are taking as they reconstruct the IT infrastructure is looking at, can we get encourage the consultants to self-serve, because they're actually quite good at that. They understand the data sets and so on, and actually putting things together. And when you look at tools such as Power BI and so on, there's lots of new things which people can actually start using in a more imaginative way. But again, I think this is where we need to go into the next stage of publication and away from the current publication schemes, which are well out of date.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Stephen, did you answer?
I want to applaud what you've just said about transparency, because that's effectively what you've been talking about. And you, in your initial reflections to the committee this morning, you talked about how you felt the FOI was in a reasonably good place in Scotland. But that's not the same thing as saying that the culture that surrounds transparency and accountability is in a good place. So 16 weeks in, here's a difficult question, but I actually don't think you'll ever be in a better place to answer this, because you're brand new. Yep. What is your assessment of the overall public sector culture in respect to transparency, accountability, accessibility?
I think it varies. First of all, I would say that the information teams on the ground are hugely committed to that, and that's from across the public authorities. They're very, very keen to do things. I think the challenge comes where you get further up the tree. When you get to the top of the organisations, there's resistance.
That's where I'm pointing you.
Yes. I think there's a piece of work to be done there in terms of valuing that work and why it's important. And I think the public attitude surveys are quite clear in saying that people have trust. I think it's about 75% trust, more trust if you have a good freedom of information regime in an organisation. And I think this is where this goes back to the fundamentals of open governance. And that's, I don't just mean in government, I mean across the public authorities. Yeah. That if we can encourage people to appreciate the fact that if you're open with your data, people will trust you.
What are the obstacles? What is it in the senior echelons of public sector organisations is seen as a barrier? What's the downside?
I think there's a reputational aspect. There's a concern about reputation. Sure. Yeah. I think there's also a lack of investment in some of these teams, because I've heard one comment from a health board that was essentially saying, trying to save lives here, why do they need to be answering freedom of information requests? Well, I think you just need to look at what's going on in terms of hospitals, inquiries, etc., to understand why that doesn't add up. But that is an attitude that prevails by some at senior levels. Yeah. But what we have also seen is that the right senior people making the right decisions can turn round organisations massively. And I would say the Scottish Government is a good example of that, where the new Permanent Secretary has absolutely grasped FOI with both hands, and now we are seeing the merits of that and the fruits of that labour. It's now embedded in the culture and the management culture.
You're targeting the people at the top.
So that's where my laser sights are moving.
Good. Crosshairs. Absolutely.
Right. I want to go and get into the authorities and speak, to have those high-level conversations. And this is why it matters. These are the benefits for you, and you know you've got to do it.
And have you got all the powers you need? Has Parliament granted you everything you need to be able to create that leverage?
I think there's perhaps some tweaking needed there. I mean, I think we've seen some pretty bad comments publicly regarding people which I've described as subverting the principles of FOI. I think that needs to be dealt with. That seems bizarre that's an acceptably legally.
Yeah.
Had there been a freedom of information request, and there may yet be one, I don't know yet, that was live regarding to that, then it becomes an offence. But if it's not, then it isn't.
Yeah.
So there is a gap there in my thinking that we need a bit more teeth regarding that kind of cultural piece, as to if you try to evade FOI and get caught doing that, then there should be some kind of penalty.
Give St George a bigger spear to take on the dragon.
Yes.
All right.
Certainly there is, and has been for some time, provision in the Section 60 Code for senior management responsibility for FOI in every organisation.
But so, cultural
which, yes, which, and to agree on a degree on culture as well. And certainly we have pursued interventions and at least in one case a practice recommendation on the basis of issues relating to senior management taking responsibility for FOI within an organisation.
It could well be, though, that some of the people that are long-term servers in some of these organisations at the top are just not suited in leadership terms for the more transparent, accountable culture that we would all like to see across government.
They may not be.
Yeah.
I think it's got to be on an individual basis, but what I have seen is some excellent leadership and some less excellent leadership.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you, Stephen. Evelyn, can I turn to you?
Yes, thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. And I would like to follow up on some of Ivan's points, just to kick off. David, you spoke about the backlog. What does the backlog look like? And at the present time, what is your longest case that's sitting in that backlog? And can you also tell us, the committee, how you're interacting with people that are sitting in the backlog? How are you updating them on progress?
Yes. So what we've called this is called Project Blue, for no reason. I've actually FOI'd in that as to whether there's a reason for the colour. So I suppose that's the system working well. it was just a random colour. We currently have 329 cases in our backlog, including those that we're still validating as to whether they're live cases. And unfortunately, we had a bit of a perfect storm last November when we ended up with a significant surge in cases that came in. We were up to over 70 that month, and also with some staffing challenges just within the office, which slowed that up. But we're back on top of that again. Our oldest case currently is 14th of June 2022. That is, I think we all would agree, absolutely unacceptable, but it's a matter of fact that we just have to deal with, and it's something which we are dealing with. In terms of the engagement, first of all, we've explained very clearly to all the stakeholders as to how we're dealing with this and the rationale for it. And in, by and large, most people are entirely accepting of that, and they see the benefit of it. It's about protecting the whole system, not just the few. We've also been briefing the public authorities on aspects of this and trying to make it clear how we are trying to move through this, asking them to review actively the cases, because as cases get older, often the rationale and the reasons for not releasing the data changes. So we've asked them to do that. We've also asked the applicants, do they wish to review that, do they still need the data? Is it still relevant? Because the story may have moved on. It may have been something different. I think we've had varying degrees of success with that, in all truth. A lot of people who, particularly from the applicants, they want their decision, and they want sometimes it can be fairly academic in terms of a principle, but it's their right to have that decision, and if that's what they want, then we will go through the process of doing so. I suppose the biggest challenge is making sure that we've just got to keep the two going. Now, we're going to continue reporting everything as currently is, as a whole, but what we do now have is some subcontext to be able to say, well, the new cases coming through as of 1st of January are going straight through and getting dealt with, and that we are dealing with this backlog to separately as a contained, definable project, and we're working our way through that and trying to pair up, trying to look at themes that are here, and we're also looking at trying to find particular specialist resources who are good on particular aspects of it to try and deal with it, not necessarily chronologically as we would do, but in terms of the best approach for the whole system. So some people are not happy about it, and I entirely understand that, but I think the majority are thinking this does make sense, it is the right way to do it, and I think we just need to carry on with that.
And David, if someone is sitting in that backlog, what sort of update are you giving them on their specific case? Because if people have been, there's 329 cases, and the oldest one is June 2022, are you giving them a sort of full picture of where you are? What exact information are you giving them?
We're giving people, what I've told them so far is it's not a case of you're number 15 in the queue. It's more a case of here's the approach we're taking. And we've also, for those with multiple applications, for example, we're saying, what are your priorities? We're trying to empower them to say, well, what is it, you know, before we look at this one, you might be one that is further up the list. So you tell us what your priorities are. So we're trying to empower some of the applicants in this as well to make sure that they've got a say in it. We do have regular contact with people anyway to give them an update on their cases. It's an important part of that service delivery that we tell them. And we record all those and make sure that we do everything we can to keep them in the loop.
And do you give them a timescale for when you think that the complaint is going to be, or the issue is going to be dealt with?
Maybe I'll ask Ewan, who's as head of enforcement, if you can.
At present, no. As we get through and get a better picture of the backlog and those cases that are more ready for resolution promptly, we should be in a better position to do that. There are undoubtedly cases that will be more straightforward to address than others, and that's part of the sort of triage process that we're going through initially with the backlog. And we should, after that, be in a better position to have a good idea of how long the remainder is going to take.
Publish on our website on a monthly basis the status of every case, live case that we have open with us, in addition to the regular contact that our investigators make with each applicant.
It's understandable that applicants who have been waiting some time will want to hold out for a decision, absolutely. And that's coupled with, I think it's fair to say that we get a fair number of applicants who are quite entrenched by the time they come to us anyway. And that's probably due to a number of factors, but there will be a good number of cases where the FOI request is tied up with other issues the applicant has had with the authority, and in some way or other the relationship has broken down over time. Mm.
Sorry, Evan, I was just going to ask, your oldest case is June 22. Is that an outlier? What's your second oldest case?
It is a bit of an outlier. I think the second oldest is a couple of months newer than that.
Right, yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. Sorry.
I think what would ease some of the frustrations, we see backlogs in other areas of our work, is that if you can give, you know, a good response and an update on a sort of regular basis, and that will ease frustrations, I think, for people who are in that backlog. And a sort of reflection of what you're actually doing rather than working on it.
I agree entirely with that, and I think this is where the customer services piece is so important in terms of giving that reassurance to people that they're not being forgotten. And this is one of the risks which we identified. We don't want this to be looked like we're just ignoring it, sweeping it under the carpet. As far as I'm concerned, there's a massive big bump in the carpet and it needs to go, and we will finish that job before we can close that off. So it needs to happen. I guess the challenge is, and we're still at that assessment stage, there's not a quick way of saying, scanning through things and saying that's easy, that's not. It does actually need a bit of investigation just to find out what the low-hanging fruit is, what the easy, quick wins are, and that's the process we're in just now, trying to sort of triage those and get them worked out what we can do. I think the next stage for that is, as you rightly say, is can we give people an expectation as to when this is going to land? And that's something which I think we should be able to do. Once we get a grip of that the numbers, because it is a significant number to have as a qualitative exercise, just trying to work out where everything sits. And again, we've got to, most importantly, preserve the existing workflow coming through. And, you know, touch wood, if we can continue that we don't get any significant spikes, then that allows us to do that. And of course, if we get any dips in current workflow, then we can divert resource into dealing with the backlog quicker.
Certainly, we did at the beginning of this year write to all applicants individually to explain what we were doing in relation to Project Blue, in relation to the backlog. And we have written to them periodically in between. The expectation with an active case would be that the applicant would be updated every 2 months. We haven't stuck strictly to that in relation to our backlog because obviously it's not always helpful simply explaining that nothing's happening. But we certainly had contact with all applicants at least twice, I think, in the past year. And in addition to the correspondence we put out in January.
OK, thank you for that. Can you give the committee a progress update on your intervention with SEPA, David?
SEPA, yes, certainly. Got some details here. So the SEPA intervention was opened in June 2021, and the work continues to support the agency rebuilding its FY performance following the cyber attack. A significant issue of the intervention was accessing to reliable and comprehensive performance monitoring data. And that work has now been undertaken by SEPA, not only to collect the most comprehensive data sets from FOI performance can be measured, but also a wider project to rebuild its wider access to information regime. And again, that's what I was talking about, the self-service from consultants and so on. We set a target of 80% for responses due on or under the time limit by December 2023. And then that will go up to 90% from 1st of April 2024. And our latest performance figures from them was 85.5%. So they are performing well on that and responding to the targets which have been set for them. So, again, we just keep a watch on it. They've been through a pretty awful time, but not helped, I would have to say, by some of their approaches which they've taken as well. We did give them some advice as to how to deal with some of the cases which they were dealing with, but they didn't follow through in that by informing all the applicants how they were dealing with their appeals. And that's now been rectified, and they are now being contacted in a managed and a measured way to make sure that they don't get swamped, which is not in anyone's interest. But I think, again, it's been a difficult time for the agency, but hopefully they will be in a much better position at the end of it. And it's also giving them an unexpected opportunity to trial some of these new technologies, both in terms of self-service and also we believe that looking at redaction software as well to see if they can that can help with processing things quicker. So a lot of interest there.
So generally going in the right direction?
Going in the right direction, yes. Claire, who's been leading on the SEPA intervention, can give you some any more further details beyond what I've said.
Absolutely. The team at SEPA have been working incredibly hard. They did find themselves in quite a unique position in terms of the backlog that they received. Obviously, a large percentage of that backlog was information requests made under the environmental information regulations, slightly different than FOI in that there are very strict time limits. So a lot of that backlog had been time barred in terms of appeals to us and the right to seek a review, which is why the position they took was to close those requests and advise everyone impacted to make a new request for information. The other aspect to that as well is that they have to consider the request at the time it was made. And at that time, obviously, they had difficulty accessing information. So the responses to a large majority of those requests would have been the information's not held. So I think they've taken the correct approach. They've worked incredibly hard. As David mentioned, they're investing in using AI software in terms of as a redaction tool. They've invested in more staff. They're trying to rebuild a sustainable access to information regime, and they're building more public registered. So, as David already mentioned, that ability to self-serve. So I'm hoping this will be held up as a good case study for other authorities in the future.
Can I just ask, because obviously you're monitoring the response, which is what the target is for, and they're above that. And you've talked about the access to information regime, the ATI. Are you satisfied that's as far along the pathway as it should be?
I think given the impact of the cyber incident on them, the fact that they've managed to invest quite heavily in staff and also its senior management buy-in. Again, invariably with all these interventions, it's when senior management buy-in to the access regime, that's when real differences are made.
That's fine. Just before I move on, I suppose it would be helpful to address, and I'm going to add the word carefully, the intervention with regard to the Scottish Government at the moment. So I understand, well, I'm aware that you sent a letter on the 7th of February seeking additional information, and that time to provide the information was still within it. I think, is it next Friday? Or Thursday or Friday expires. I suppose my question just at this stage, because obviously you don't have the information, is have you received any confirmation that the information can be provided by your requested date, or are you worried that it might not appear? Whoever.
I have been given assurances that it will arrive with us by the 29th of February. There may be some additional information that we require and some follow-up questions from this. So, yes, I've been provided with assurances that that will come in on time.
That's incredibly helpful. Thank you. and then I suppose there is a question about the intervention activity in that in the report there was concern that the ability to intervene had been restricted because of resource implications and things like that. Do you want to give the committee just a short explanation about how that came about, but probably more importantly, and I think this is actually to re-emphasise the fact that going forward, your intervention capacity is back to where you hope it should be.
I think it's one of the frustrations that I share with my predecessors is that the intervention's function is, without doubt, in my view, the best value of the toolkit, because essentially it deals with systemic issues and it's cross-platform, it's different authorities. So I think the ability to actually take the learning from one authority and apply that across, no matter the size of it, it works at different at scale, whether it's Scottish Government or whether it's a small dental practice. It's the same issues that we can help with people regarding that. And I think the frustration we have is that it's not something that has ever been resourced as part of the function of the Information Commissioner, Scottish Information Commissioner. And it's something that I think needs to be bolstered and have that dedicated team to do that, because the benefits for everyone will be better. This is classic prevention. Coming from a policing perspective, you know, you don't want the crime to happen. You want to stop it happening in the first place before having to detect it. So that's where I see the future, I think, for us needs to look at that more seriously and see, can we get involved here and dedicate the resource to it? Because at the moment, it's literally robbing Peter to pay Paul within the organisation. And if we take resource off our enforcement capability, that means we don't get the backlog cleared. It means we can't deal with our existing things happening. If we take it from our policy and information side of things, we can't do the training, we can't do the policy support, which is equally important just now. So it's something that I think I'll probably be, in fact, I will be coming back next year saying, can I have some money?
Even before that. And you did have one level four intervention in respect of a council, but that's now been completed and closed. Have you had the ability to review the process of that level four intervention to take the best practice from that going forward?
Again, I'll speak to Claire on this one.
Ewan.
Was that Aberdeen?
Aberdeen, yes.
Yeah. Yes, I think we have we identified the learning points from that, and I think we publicised them fairly well.
Yeah, quite a discreet point as well.
Yes.
That one was very specific. It was unlike our level three interventions where learning can be much more broad. This was a very particular issue that we had to deal with. And as far as I'm aware, it has been handled.
The specific point of why the level four, but actually the fact that it was a level four intervention, which is in itself highly unusual.
Yes.
And whether it, I suppose, I mean, my obvious question is, did local authorities realise the significance and the importance of a level four? And are you able to take the generic experience of doing a level four intervention to say to local authorities in particular, watch out, but we are here to support you, not punish you?
Yes. Well, I think the authority in question certainly realised the importance at the time. The practice recommendation was published, and I think fairly widely publicised on our website. And yes, it was a fairly specific point, but it did tie into issues we have discussed earlier about senior management buy-in and senior management understanding of their role in relation to FOI. And from that point of view, it is important, I think. Yes,
that's helpful. And I suppose my last question, in this section is probably aimed to you, David, in that, in a sense, the approach to initiating new interventions has changed substantially in the last 16 weeks. and I'm just really to give you the opportunity to discuss the concept of being proactive about information that comes available rather than reactive following a request that's put in, usually from a member of the public, and whether that is a change, whether it's a change in approach, or whether it is just a response to circumstances that you become aware of.
I think, to be honest, it's circumstances more than anything. The interventions process is fairly well documented and it's been used, and there are quite significant numbers on that we've done. I mean, we've done several hundred, I think, the actual numbers. But we've done many. It's not an uncommon thing to happen. I think the challenge is that we are reticent to escalate too quickly, and we've sometimes been sitting around looking at whether an intervention should be opened, but also aware of our capacity, and that's a frustrating piece, because we want to do this, we think this would be, the authority would benefit from it, but we can't because we don't have that resourcing. I think one of the key things here is that authorities, by and large, welcome interventions. This is another thing, which is, it's not a punitive process, it's not adversarial, it's about support. We get them to do the work and they've come out in a better position. And what we've had is a number of testimonies from authorities who have gone through that process, who say, really welcome this. This actually was good at first, but actually this worked out okay, and actually we're in a better position now. So I think that's a positive to take from it. The process for identifying interventions is also quite interesting in terms of how we're not looking at just enforcement aspects of complaints. We will, of course, look at that. But we are looking at other intelligence which we're gathering. We're getting information coming in from the authorities, and we can monitor that and see what where they're at with things. Highlight it, flags up to us where there are issues. I think I'd like to develop that a little bit more in terms of a kind of intelligence gathering piece, whereby people who have got concerns with an authority and its practices can submit something to us without necessarily having to have an enforcement appeal in process. And I think that just gives us that richer picture where we can look at this and find out where we need to focus resources, look at thematic issues, and again, if we need to take that across the board, do so.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. I'm going to turn to Stephen or Annie.
I'm okay just now.
All right. Stephen, do you want to do the
Well, OK, let me come back to our earlier conversation about teeth.
Is the dentist or
just... No, we won't be bringing up NHS dentists. We did that yesterday. We're not doing that today. I mean, I think what I'm interested to hear is more about what you feel the current legislation, where the current legislation is lacking. You mentioned, you know, you with a slight tone of exasperation, some of the games playing that you alluded to in relation to FOI law as it currently stands. Can I ask you to elaborate on where you feel changes in primary legislation would give you the sufficient powers you need and the leverage you need in order to bring about that change of culture that I certainly would like to see?
Yeah, I think the key thing, I mean, first of all, the powers which are invested in me are actually good, and I think they work well, and they've stood the test of the time, and they've got to be proportionate in terms of what we're looking for. I do think, though, that I find if there is a suggestion that there has been some kind of subversion of the principles of freedom of information, that's wrong, and that should not be tolerated. And until we have something specific, because there are criminal offences within the Freedom of Information Scotland Act, but they are very specific, and the remit is very quite specific in terms of there has to have been a request for that information. So, again, how do you know, as a regulator, whether that request has been made or not, and whether that's, so that there is a bit of, I think this is why this has become an issue as a consequence of the COVID UK inquiry, because perhaps uniquely it has opened up a box there which probably would not have been opened in all truth in the past. So that's where we need to have a look at, and just now that we are aware of some of the things that have come out in public, then we need to dig into that a bit more and just reassure ourselves or take action as to what we find in there. But I think that aside, what we have seen already does present me with concern. And I do have other people on the back of that inquiry who have contacted the office to say that they're concerned about this particular practice that happens in a particular authority. Now, in the absence of an appeal, I don't have any locus for that. I can't deal with that. So I suppose my gateway into this is very narrow. And I've got to be able to match that. Now, it just happens, as I say, that the circumstances are which has opened up for the COVID inquiry, which allows for that intervention piece. But in the absence of that, I don't really think there's any... I don't have an actual way in. And I think a lot of people have got frustration about that as to why you're not doing something about this. Yeah. But it's just not there. I think the other thing which is important to me, the difference is that I'm not the Transparency Commissioner. A lot of people expect, well, that's not right, and that's not right. And yeah. I mean, my mailbox has gone extraordinary in the last few weeks in terms of some of the things that people want me to fix. Yeah. But it's not my remit. It's very much defined in the legislation as freedom of information, and it needs that gateway in to be able to actually operate. So I think that's there needs to be perhaps a discussion. If people want me to do more than that, then there needs to be a review of that gateway. I think if people are unhappy about clear evidence of that subversion of the principles of FOI, then we need to look at that again, or others need to look at that again and tell them what they wish from it. But it is a frustration for me in terms of trying to promote the regime and give people trust and confidence in it if we don't have those tools.
So trust, obviously, in government in general, not just in Scotland, but across the United Kingdom, is a pretty crucial issue of the moment. So much has happened that have led people to doubt, not competence as much as trust and confidence. So it is very important that we get this right for the sake of our democratic institutions and our democratic way of life. I mean, that sounds very dramatic, but in actual fact, that is what we're talking about. What I'm concerned about is your ability to resource that kind, however narrow the route into this area of inquiry, your ability to properly... You've got, what, 24 staff, one office, not a huge budget, really. I mean, do you have the strength of arms to be able to take on that kind of a very broad, very, very fundamental issue in your role? In terms of information, not transparency.
Yeah. I mean, it would be no surprise to say that, no is the answer. But I think that's a justifiable no. And that's because I'm looking at this, and again, the benefit of being in the door is thinking, is this all we've got for the size of this task? Yeah. Now, eventually I'll become institutionalised. Because I'll see, oh, that's just how it is. That's what happens with commissioners.
this parliament will help you stay
in. I hope not. But I think the reality is it's the freshness of my approach at the moment is that I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, this is unusual. I can't believe we've only got this. And I think I said it at one of the meetings, so where is everyone? And this is it. It's like, what, really? It does at times feel thin and it's perhaps too lean as it is. And again, that's for me to make the case now. And again, that's where we were talking about strategic case. For the first plan for me was stabilise. Next stage is to grow and develop and to support the regime the way it needs to be. But fundamentally, if we want to do more, we will need more resource. And I'm... You know, there is a definite case for that.
Yeah, I'm just concerned about how you deal with the immovable object. So in some respects, you've mentioned the new head of the civil service in Scotland, John Paul Marks, who's much more amenable to this whole cultural approach than perhaps had existed previously. But the issue was, for example, the James Hamilton, and I'm not going to ask you to comment about anything specific, but the overall principle here is that a member of the public sought an FOI, and this whole thing ended up in the Supreme Court, where it was finally disclosed that the Scottish Government had not told the truth about what they had and what they didn't have. And then there was a ruling about what was FOI-able. Now the Scottish Government are saying, in this morning's newspapers, there's an update on this, and I know you've not commented on this, and I will respect whatever you choose to respond to what I'm saying, how you choose to respond to what I'm saying, but the Scottish Government, in relation to the possibilities of a further appeal to you, have said that you have confirmed the requirements of the decision notice of the Supreme Court have been complied with. This all sets the stage, doesn't it, for this immovable object, tackling the immovable object. What exactly happens in a situation where you, as the commissioner, having now got a new definition of what is FOI-able in relation to this specific case, and yet the holder of that information says, I'm not disclosing any more information, what exactly do you do, given the limitation of your resources?
Well, I mean, ultimately, it's a legal instrument. Ultimately, this is, I will make a decision, and if either applicant or authority is not happy with that, they have the right to take that to the Court of Session and challenge it on matters of law. Yeah. I think that is the practice, that's the process, and it's why we need to make sure we get it right with quality decisions that are justifiable and stand up. And, you know, we've got a very, very good track record in the Court of Session and indeed elsewhere by the fact that we don't get many challenges to what we have. And again, that's trust, in terms of the organisation. So ultimately, we just need to allow that process to take its place forward. It's not about personalities, it's not about politics, it's a fundamentally a legal process and
law.
Application
yeah.
of law.
Yeah.
And essentially what we, as an office, we're a kind of judicial, quasi-judicial body that makes assessments on that, and there's an appeal process to that. So we will just do what we do as the right thing to do, and if the Court of Session finds in a different way, well, that's law, and it's you know, I've done my bit and they've done their bit.
All right, that's a very fair response.
If I may. Yes. Yes, we have confirmed that we are satisfied that the Scottish ministers have complied with the decision notice that was before the court.
Have a review.
In that they have carried out a review in relation to information the court accepted, they held, yes. And so that has been done. And the ministers have carried out the review, they've responded to the requester, and we now have a further appeal, which we will have to consider.
Yeah.
On the substance of
based on the substance of what is FOIable.
Yeah.
That the Scottish Government now accept they have got this information. It's just, right. We'll leave that there, because I'm sure I'll be stopped by the convener otherwise. pushing the envelope, though, that's all part of the transparency of the job. You mentioned the disappointment you felt about the Government's attitude to amending the Act specifically. Do you want to just explore that a bit more with us in terms of where you would have liked to have seen a more positive response from the Government?
Yeah, I think the public consultation that the government had was very clear in the terms of there's an appetite for change across Scotland, both in terms of authority, in terms of applicants. And I think there were some missed opportunities that would have promoted Scotland's transparency and openness in an international stream. I think it has been harmed as a result of not taking the opportunities to do that. There are a number of measures which are in the bill which have never been used, such as the First Minister's veto. It's never been used, therefore why do we have it is one of these things. There's also questions regarding as to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service as to whether they should be fully covered by FOI. There's a question as to if somebody FOIs me, and I give a decision, then I can't, at the moment, somebody else in my office can't review that. And again, that just means that the only court, or the only avenue open is for someone to take me to the court of session on regarding that. And again, that's, I think, denying a little bit of that kind of natural justice to people there. I think probably the biggest thing, though, is this publication scheme. And I think that's I don't think there's enough in the tweaking of codes regarding publication schemes that are there. And I mean, to put it in context, the publication schemes were written at a time where 9% of people had access to broadband, you know, it was, and 50% to the internet. It was 20 years old. It's archaic in terms of what it was. There was a manual paper filing system as to here's what you should publish. It pre-existed Google. You know, and I think now we're in a different space. Absolutely. And I think this is where we, the difficulty we have is that the scheme is set up in a way that it's a kind of become a tick box exercise. Yeah. So we'll just put people in little folders and here's what we do. It's not interesting or dynamic. It doesn't allow people to ask the right questions. Most people search for things on search engines now. And, you know, in the future, of course, ChatGPT is going to come through as well with all these different references. You know, we need to get a different place with that, and we would rather just have a duty to publish. You know, proactively publish your information is a much easier way rather than stipulating how you should do it, because that, as soon as you start stipulating, people go to the lowest common denominator and say, well, tick the box there, that's fine. We need to go further than that. And I think that's
I'd love to know how many of these... How many did you say there were? 80,000?
83,000.
I'd love to know how many of those are follow-up, because asking the right question hasn't... You know, haven't got the right question, therefore they've been answered absolutely according to the question they'd asked, so they think, I've got to ask another question. You know, in the same way that you might interrogate Google, actually, until you get...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
As more iterative questions.
Well, in such a waste of time and money,
yeah.
Compared with what you're suggesting, which is a far more open approach to information management. Can I ask you about Katie Clark's private members bill? Because I was a little intrigued, and I probably need you to help me understand what this means. You know, in her bill, she's got things like the creation of a new statutory officer with designated responsibility for FOI in public authorities, to which I think your office response is partially supportive. So you're, you know, I always feel this is the, if if no one will be offended, it's this thing about being partially pregnant. You know, I mean, are you for it or against it? I mean, I think it'd be useful to know. I hope no one's offended by my reference in that direction. But
the position on pregnancy is for or against.
Well, you either are or you aren't, right?
I mean, yes. Shouldn't there be?
Yeah.
Well, I will. The response to that predated me, so if you don't mind, I'll ask Claire to fill in on that. I think the general principle, as I picked up, was from the past response, was more about the fact that there are elements of it make sense, but in practice, it's actually more difficult to do. But I shall probably be corrected by.
Yeah, no, I think that pretty much sums it up. Is that, you know, the FOI should be responsibility throughout the organisation as well. It's not just down to one individual. Yes. I think that's the key aspect there, although we can absolutely see the benefits of having a statutory officer in place, somewhat like the requirements of the Data Protection Act. But equally, FOI transcends much wider than one individual.
I think that's the problem. Yeah, exactly. What you're really saying is that everybody in every avenue of public service should be responsible for information management within their remit.
It's cultural, and it's also about system design.
Yeah.
And I think, again, this is another one for the future, is that we need to see information management systems embedding freedom of information at design stage. And I know there's work getting on by some of the IT companies looking about data sharing between different agencies. I know policing for a good example of that. But actually, we need to go further than that in terms of, do we need to have this stuff, you know, behind firewalls at all? Yeah. And actually switching that round into this is public knowledge, people should have access to it.
Yeah, because you create one role with a responsibility for something that's good across the whole organisation culturally, and the organisation goes to sleep on that cultural value.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's true of quality, just as it's true of information. Mm-hmm. And the other thing you've got here's another, we've got to work this one out, reduction of exemptions to the Act. So I think this is a redefinition of what is FOIable, basically, particularly in relation to procurement, as I understand the bill. And your response to that was partially opposed. What does that mean, partially opposed?
I think what we were saying there is that we think the exemptions that are in place at the moment work well.
Right.
Some of them could have some tinkering, but largely they work well in practice, so we don't see necessarily the reason to reduce them. I'm not quite sure the point about procurement directly.
Well, I think it had to do with the fact that public...
In relation to, I think, the submission you made with regard to the government proposals, that the organisations that FOI should apply to, I think in the government response you said was probably best dealt with as a schedule rather than as a gatekeeping.
Yes.
And I think the same question was asked in a slightly different way in Katie Clark's about the extent to which it should apply.
And I mentioned procurement because that's much of public service delivery is now done by commercial operations. And that's well and good. But there is a limitation in terms of how much information commercial operations are liable to provide on an FOI basis, if any at all.
I think that's probably the observation that I, going back to the beginning, as to what I felt when we started looking at some of these commercial aspects, because it is a very delicate balancing act, and then when you start putting public interest tests on top of that, then you're into very challenging and actually something you really need to have a ponder over. And I think that's the thing that has perhaps surprised me more than anything coming into this role, is the complexity of some of these calls. But I think in terms of if there's a danger of over-legislating on definitions and exemptions, and actually having the parameters which we have in terms of the exemptions, for me, works because it also allows a degree of case law, and it allows a degree of future-proofing as well. And I think in Katie Clark's bill talked about defining information further. Yeah. That probably is not such a good thing to happen, particularly given some recent court cases, whereby it's been very clear what the definition of information is and what's held or not. Yeah. To define that takes you into territory where you're actually unintended consequences kick in, and that's what we don't want to be.
Yeah, you've got to be careful. You don't ask a question you don't necessarily want the answer to. And I think that's a good place. I mean, the other dimension of that, of course, is that when commercial operations are bidding to work in the public sector, to deliver public services, you know, they already go through hoops of fire in order to even be considered as potential providers of that service. And on top of that, if you ladled all the other costs of what we're describing. So there's many dimensions of that. I actually think I've probably exhausted my well of questions.
That's fine. It's lovely to come to the
Ivan McKee looks as if he's just leaving.
And I think with regard to the question of legislation, it is something that we will clearly return to. Can I thank you, David, and can I thank your staff for coming this morning? You have survived. And we will no doubt see you again. If there is anything subsequently that you feel you'd like to add, please feel free to write to the clerks in the normal way. But can I thank you for your attendance today, and I will now close the public part of this meeting.